We're going to show you how to make distribution maps today in ArcGIS Pro. First, open up the table that you added onto your map. Now, this table, you put all your data in Excel, and it has your stoneware count, your porcelain count, whatever artifact data that you would like your distribution map to have. So we are going to apply a join onto either the polygon file that you have your test units on or the point. For my project, I had only taken a sample of the test units and recorded their artifact information. So as you can see, I have a separate feature class file for that information, but I still do have a test unit file. So whatever file it is that you're going to be joining to the table, whether that be just a sample or all your test units or your STPs, you're going to go ahead and right-click it, click Join and Relates, and then click Add a Join. So automatically, it should have your input table as the table of that polygon or point that you're joining the information to. So the field that I'm planning on joining is the unit field, but you might have a different field. Like you might call it STPs or coordinates or whatever, but you're going to put that in the input join field. If you only have one Excel table on your contents panel, it will automatically place that in the join table field. But if not, you can choose what Excel table you would like to use. And when you put the input join field, it's smart enough to figure out that you want probably units, like if it shares the same name, we'll put it as your join table field. But if that's not actually the field you want, you can go drop down and click the right field. So the data is now joined. You can right click your polygon or point file again and it's all there. However, it's still connected to the table and it's not independent of the table. Once you remove that join, all that data goes away. But we can use the data from the Excel sheet to calculate a field into the polygon or point file and give a permanent place for that information. So these are all the fields that I would like to create artifact distribution maps for. As you can tell, the top row, it says null values. So I think that there was a misstep in my sample that I collected where I didn't get the data for one of the units. And I can go ahead and fix that later. I like to hide the fields that I don't need, so I'm just going to go ahead and hide that polygon information. Now I'm going to go to that upper corner and click Add Field, and it's going to take me to a new page. As you can see, all the information from that join is there, and it labels all of the fields that were joined with whatever the Excel sheet's name was beforehand. So you know what fields are part of the join and what aren't. Now we're going to add new fields, which are essentially just copies of the fields we have in the Excel table, but they're just put on the polygon. So I'm going to start with a stoneware count and go down. The field name is what it's going to be stored as, so don't put any spaces. I always underscore, but some people keep the underscore out and they'll just capitalize one word or whatever. Up to you, as long as you don't leave any spaces. The alias is where you can put spaces, so if you wanted it to be more clear, you can say stoneware count with like a space as you would write it normally. For the data type, long is fine for our purposes, but there's actually different capabilities each data type has, so I'm going to put a link in the description that explains that a little bit further. I'm going to go ahead and skip me typing out everything because it's the same process. So before you do anything else, go up to Save. It's in your Fields tab, and this saves all the fields. If you forget to save your fields, it actually can cause problems later when you're trying to create and add new stuff to your map. So your next step is to scroll down to your first field that you need to calculate, and as you can tell, it all says null because there's no values there. But we can calculate it, so right-click it and go down to Calculate Field. A new window appears now. And as you can tell, it has your input table and the field name. There's a box on the left-hand side that shows you the fields that you have in your table currently. And you can go and scroll up to find the field that you'd like to apply. I want to apply stoneware count. So I double-click it, and then on that bottom right there, it appears. And it will say GIS data, stoneware count, because that's the table it's from. Then I click apply, and then it applies that calculation to that field. So it applies that calculation to the field, and now all the values are no longer null, and they reflect the same values as the table. I'm going to go ahead and do this for the rest of the fields. Once you're done calculating all the fields, make sure you go to the Edit tab and click Save. similar to the fields, you need to do this each time you add any information. Otherwise, it's going to cause you some problems. While you're at it, save the whole project. You can now remove the join, so right-click that polygon or point file and go to Remove All Joins, and it'll remove all the joins you have onto that file. This next step you don't have to do with STPs because they're point files, but with test units you would because they're polygon files and you can't spline a polygon. So you're going to go into the tools and type in Feature to Point. This will allow you to create points at the center of all your polygons. For the input features, put in your test units that you're studying. You're going to want to rename it to something that makes sense, like test unit centers. Make sure you check the inside box, and that will put it at the center of the test unit. As you can see, there's now a point at the center of each of the test units. You're going to go back to Tools and search Spline. We want our input features to be our test unit centers. Scroll down to the field that you'd like to display in your distribution map. I'm going to display a total artifact count. So now it's done being run, and now it's just a square, and it's not exactly morphed to the study area. And as you can see, it's trying to interpret stuff that's outside of the study area, and this can cause some problems if you're trying to analyze the data. Each point or test unit is providing data for the spline around it. So if there's a lot of green around a test unit, that means there's not a lot of artifacts there. And if there's a lot of red, that means there is a lot of artifacts there. And as you can tell on this map, there are spaces where there's no test units that are being estimated that have green and red being estimated there. This can cause analysis of the data to be skewed. Can restrict the spline to a study area. That way it only interprets the areas around where the test units were dug. So in the catalog pane, right-click the database and click New Feature Class. Name it Study Area and click Finish. You might need to add it to your Contents pane from your catalog pane. Go to the Edit tab, then click Create. Click Study Area. And then you can begin drawing your polygon around the area that you would like to include in your study. Once you have your study area defined, go back to the spline tool and fill out the information as you did in the previous step. And then go into Environments and under Mask, go to your study area polygon. Run your spline, and now you can see once you make your study area invisible that it has confined itself to that polygon that you defined. But the colors aren't exactly something I want. I don't really like having white being the most extreme, so you can actually change that by right-clicking your spline and going to Symbology. Then you can go to Color Scheme and scroll down to a color gradient that you like more. Now we need to fix the values. As you can tell, it doesn't quite make sense. You can't have negative 150 artifacts. The least amount of artifacts you can have at a site is zero. So we need to change those numbers to reflect that. Also, it's better to not have decimals as your numbers. We want to have nice whole numbers that make map reading easier. So I always start off by making the dark green a zero and then going down to red and rounding it up to the high value. I try to keep the numbers consistent, for example, going 0, 5, 10, 15, or 25, 50, 75, 100, instead of rounding the numbers of the upper values that the spline has already estimated. If you need more classes, you can always go into Method and click Natural Breaks, and then the Classes field will open up, and you can define it as 9, 10, 8, whatever you need. And that's it. Now you can see where there's a lot of artifacts or where there's not a lot of artifacts, and it can help you understand your site a little bit better.